Okay, hello everyone. I need to speak English because I can't speak Russian. I hope it's okay. Someone who doesn't speak English here? Or... Okay, perfect. Great, so yeah, my name is Max Kodak. I'm one of the co-founders of Lisk. I'm the CEO of Lisk, and we founded Lisk in early 2016. I designed my presentation today a little bit more focused on the blockchain applications and services. Because I think it's quite already, you're quite familiar with this already, I hope. If not, I will make a small introduction. So, Lisk is a cryptocurrency and framework to build blockchain-based decentralized applications. It's a little bit different to other technologies on the market. That means, for example, every app is running in its own sidechain. We did that in order to be more scalable and to have more flexibility for the developers. As I told you, I want to concentrate on the blockchain apps and services today. So this will be like the topic of my presentation. And I did it a little bit different this time. This time I want to give more examples and explain this with the help of that example, okay? If you think about blockchain applications, there might be a lot of different apps you could build on Lisk, okay? I took the example of social networks. You can build a social network on Lisk. And what is a social network? A social network is an app, or maybe a platform or network itself, on which users come together and post status updates, send messages, and upload pictures. So we have one module or one part of it, status updates. We have messages and pictures. What does it mean? It means in case of the status updates that you're simply writing text into a database which is accessible by everyone, to everyone. The messages is the same, but now it shouldn't be accessible by everyone, but only by one person. And pictures are a little bit bigger, okay? They're not small text, but they're full images. They might be several megabytes big. And they're also accessible by everyone. So what does it mean? In terms of status updates, you can simply save them on the blockchain. In terms of a blockchain app, you can use a sidechain for that. The messages, you can also save on the blockchain because it's just text, okay? But in terms of the messages, you might want to encrypt it. So that not everyone sees what is inside of the message. But for the example of pictures, you can save it on blockchain. The blockchain was not designed to save images on. It's only like a database, distributed database to store transactions or maybe small text on, but not images. It doesn't make sense. So you need to connect to other services which offer this kind of service. For example, Sire or Storage or IPFS. And this is possible with Lisk. You can implement different third-party technologies if you need their functionality. So you're not bound to a small limit of features where you can only use the blockchain. No, you can also use third-party technologies in order to build really powerful applications. What else does a social network need? It needs user accounts, right? You have that on Lisk with your passwords, you can generate or you can access one unique account on the blockchain. You need the blockchain for storage of the status updates, messages, and so on. You have this, you have your own sidechain on Lisk. You can fully concentrate, you don't have to worry about other applications on the network. You don't have to worry about millions of other users on other applications on the network because you have your own blockchain at Lisk. You can really concentrate everything on this one blockchain. And you need bridges to other technologies like IPFS in order to store images. I kept that extremely simple so I can explain it more easily to you. And this is all possible on Lisk, okay? So you can build a blockchain application which might be a social network, okay? But you can also build messengers because the requirements are the same, just sending messages around. You can build online shops because it's, again, just the same requirement. You need the title for the item you sell, maybe a description, maybe an image. You can build prediction markets where a big amount of people say how or what will happen, and it might happen or not, like how good. And you can build sharing economies, because it's, again, just these simple requirements. So you see, a lot of different stuff can already be built with only this small example I just pitched you. So IPFS and blockchain, okay? But this is not only Lisk. Lisk is far more. You can integrate Ethereum for smart contract execution. You can integrate other services which might provide different kinds of features to you. For example, you can also plug into centralized services like Amazon Web Services in order to hire or to rent high performance clusters to, for example, calculate computations in a decentralized way. Like City at Home, you can make it decentralized. So, yeah, blockchain applications. I just told you, you can make it decentralized. So, blockchain apps are decentralized. They're independent, so that means they're not bound by companies. If one user still wants to run a blockchain app, he can do it by just providing a node for it. They are unstoppable, or at least they should be, because they're running on a multitude of servers, and as long as one server exists, it can run. They're customizable, so that means, partly thanks to sidechain mechanism and Lisk, the developers can really implement everything they want. Maybe they have an app which only requires a block time of 1 hour, because a new value just comes in after 1 hour. So they change the blockchain format, and every 1 hour just comes a new block, so not every 10 seconds. And these are blockchain applications, okay? So they're quite powerful. You can really build many different stuff with that, all in a decentralized, maybe even trustless way. But to get a little bit more technical, not much, but a little bit, a blockchain app consists of four parts. This is one, the consensus algorithm, because the blockchain app is running on the sidechain, so the sidechain needs a consensus algorithm. It consists of the sidechain itself, has immutable storage, it has the back end, the application logic, and user interface. To explain it again, the consensus algorithm is, like you all should know and probably already have heard it like dozens of times, it's the underlying mechanism to create an agreement between all nodes on the decentralized network. So who is allowed to generate a block, or what node has what role in the network, and so on. The second part is immutable storage, so the blockchain, okay, has a decentralized database, which cannot be manipulated or altered. This allows a lot of different use cases. In terms of this simple example of the social network, you now have a social network where all data, which is once input into the social network, cannot be deleted anymore. Facebook, for example, can simply delete your images or text or status updates, but in this example, it wouldn't be possible. The application logic, as I told you already, the back end of your app, you can define functionalities and what the user can do with view a blockchain app, and the front end or the user interface, defining how it looks like and how the user can interact with it. So these are blockchain apps, okay? We have the front end, the back end, you have the blockchain as a decentralized storage, and the consensus algorithm. Okay, you have a question?
I got a question. Direct question, because it's a little bit very obviously not so noisy here.
Okay.
The question is about what is the difference between, let's say, classic social network and social network on blockchain? So.
As a developer, so we make it quite quickly, okay, and then there's the questions come at the end, but I will answer that. So in this case, you have to specify your requirements. If you want to build a social network, you have to choose for yourself. Should it be decentralized or centralized? Should it be trustless or should or do you want to have control over it, okay? And in terms of Facebook, for example, they don't want it decentralized. They want to remain in control of it.
Yeah.
But maybe you want to develop an alternative for the people.
Okay.
That means people can simply post status updates which remain there forever. And it might satisfy a very specific niche or a very specific need, okay? And this is like the difference. All blockchain parameters apply to this sidechain, to this social network now, okay?
Okay.
So we can have a chat later, I can talk
more
about it.
It's clear.
Okay, great. So, I just told you, blockchain app of the social network might only satisfy very specific needs, okay? Mostly within the decentralized industry. So you have decentralized social networks, decentralized sharing economies, decentralized messengers, and so on. But Lisk wants to make blockchain technology more accessible for everyone, not only in this decentralized industry, but really for every app developer or entrepreneur who might not be familiar with blockchain at all, but he wants to have like the attributes of it. So many apps on the market urgently need such blockchain features like immutable storage or trust or consensus algorithm or trusted execution of code, but they will not switch to a completely new framework because it's money, it's time, and it's work, okay? And the solution for them would be what we call blockchain services. And these blockchain services are simply blockchain apps, but it's like a subcategory of them. So we call them blockchain services because they offer something. And these can be integrated into any kind of app on your smartphone, either iOS or Android or computer, or even, again, in a decentralized blockchain app. And again, like I told you in the beginning, I'm taking this a little bit from another angle, because I hope at least you know a little bit the basics about this. So I want to tell you another example of a blockchain service. In this case, identity. It's, I think, one of the most used examples because it's just so obvious. What is identity? So an identity is a unique information about the user which cannot be manipulated, because an identity stays the same your whole life. You're not becoming a new person or another person. And this identity should be used, or should be able to be used, for authorization. So it should be able to say, okay, here, I'm Max, and this is really me, and I want to log in somewhere with my identity. So again, the bullet points are like unique information used for authorization and accessible from apps. That means, for example, nowadays you have, like, I don't know, 20, 30 apps on your smartphone. You have Facebook, you have Twitter, you have your email account, you have maybe an Amazon account, and you always have to make a new profile. You have to specify your credit card information, your name, your street, and so on, every time. But now imagine there's a blockchain service, an identity service, providing an identity on a global scale for the whole world, which can be integrated into any kind of centralized and decentralized app. So now, if such an app would support this identity service built on this, for example, and you simply have to type in your passphrase or whatever, maybe this can become more easier in the future, and you have access to all your information, and you can specify which information should be decrypted or should stay encrypted. For example, Facebook might not need your credit card information, but Amazon might need it. So, in terms of unique information, this is like in the beginning, okay? I think you're already tired of that, but it's like writing data into a database, and which is accessible on demand. So, not like in a social network, which information should be open in case of the status update and everyone should be able to see it. No, this information you have to decrypt in order to allow an app to access your information, so it's on demand. It should be used for authorization, so you should be able to log in with your identity and prove ownership. So disprove this, like you prove that you are really this person, okay? And accessible from all apps. Like I told you, being able to implement it into any kind of centralized or decentralized app. This can be done with simple API calls. It's extremely easy to do. This is all possible on Elasticsearch as well. It's quite easy, it's quite simple. Even now, in the world of state of Lisp itself. And yeah, like I told you, these are called blockchain services. Because, well, if you're asking yourself, why do I differentiate between blockchain apps and blockchain services? It's because often only a few components of an app actually benefit from blockchain technology. And Lisp does not replace existing app solutions, it is enhancing them by providing critical, trust-related features. You don't need to have, like, I don't know, whatever, maybe WhatsApp, you don't need to have it completely decentralized. Maybe you want to have the encryption layer on a decentralized and trustless network, or you want to have the usernames or the contact data on an encrypted network, but shouldn't, or maybe it shouldn't be all decentralized. Because decentralized always means work. Decentralized always means it's not the most efficient way of doing things, because you have to work for this decentralization. Centralizing is quite easy, and it's very fast, efficient, and this is more like a philosophical question, right? Do you want to make it centralized or decentralized? So, in case of blockchain services, there are many examples where you can build blockchain services built on Lisp for many different use cases, okay? As I told you, the immutable storage for important metadata, for usernames, for identities, for status updates which shouldn't be deleted anymore. Decentralized hosting for, like critical and risky files. For example, family photos, you don't want that Dropbox is viewing or has access to your family photos, right? So it's better to save them in a decentralized encrypted network, which where every file is like split up and distributed among a lot of different nodes. You can build as a service decentralized computation for sensitive calculations. For example, if you are running a casino and you need to generate a random number, how do you do that? It's extremely complicated. And you need to prove that this random number is really random and it's not like tinkered so that you can make more money as a casino. So it really needs to be a real random number. So how do you do that? Maybe on Lisp, okay, in terms of a decentralized trustless network. You can build oracles or oracle services for real opinions instead of going back and making surveys or analyses and so on. You just ask people, like 1,000 people, give a small amount of money to them and they will give you their opinion. And smart contracts for a truly trustless computation of code. You can implement, for example, the Ethereum virtual machine directly inside the Lisp sidechain. And once this is done, everyone else can use it because it's open source, right? But we're still at the beginning and maybe this is a little bit too complicated, maybe it's not wanted, and you can then simply plug in Ethereum as a third party, as, for example, with IPFS you already did. So you can now also offer smart contract execution as a service on Lisp, which might run in a Lisp sidechain or on Ethereum itself, but you can create a service where someone pays only a few Lisp and then you can upload a smart contract and it's being executed, etc., etc. So that means everyone can add their own blockchain service, also their own blockchain app, to this platform and make it accessible for the world. Okay? And due to the federated delegated network, this is really only possible with Lisp. Because all these delegates on the network can run multiple third-party technologies, and the blockchain service can really leverage them in order to build really powerful and complex and useful applications and services. So here are a few examples. So you can use Ethereum for smart contract execution. You can use IPFS for storage of images or whatever. Storage is also possible. You can also, instead of building your own prediction market on this, simply plug into Outlook and use it inside of your app. And here is a small example graph of the network. Does this have like a laser pointer? This device? Is here a laser pointer?
No. You could use your eyes.
So I wanted to show it to the audience. Okay. So you have many different nodes on the network. Okay. And some nodes might secure the main blockchain. These are the red ones. And these are the so-called top delegates. They're securing the main blockchain and getting paid for that. But as you know, Lisk and every Lisk app and every Lisk service is running in its own sidechain because of scalability and because of customization. And you might have a blockchain service, the green dots, which is using the Bitcoin network. A small example. Maybe you have a website and you accept Bitcoin, and now you want to save resides of the items you sold on a decentralized network. You can save resides on Bitcoin, but you can make a blockchain service where you are checking the Bitcoin network all the time and scanning it for transactions of your users. And once a user of you makes a transaction, the blockchain service built on Lisk detects that and makes a new entry on the sidechain. For example, what was sold, or how expensive was it, who sold it, and so on. And in this case, Bitcoin has to be running on the nodes because, how would you check the Bitcoin blockchain in real time, right? Oracles are far too slow for that. And if you're like using a centralized blockchain explorer, it's not the best solution for that. So you need to provide, or other people need to provide delegates which are running Lisk, but also which are running Bitcoin in the background, so that the blockchain service can access the local API of Bitcoin because it needs to, okay? And this way, a lot of different blockchain apps and services becoming live, becoming a reality. And we want to really build a framework which allows the development of very complex applications, okay? We don't want simple scripts on the blockchain, like we're doing simple, really simple stuff. We want to provide a platform on which developers can really build useful apps and services. And for this, you might need other services. You might need Bitcoin, you might need Ethereum, you might need IPFS, and so on. And the biggest problem in case of, or if we speak about sidechains, the biggest problem is always security. It's a new blockchain after all, and you have to provide nodes which are securing this sidechain, okay? I don't have any fancy graphs for that, but I want to explain you a vision we have at Lisk, how we want to make it possible for blockchain apps developers and for blockchain apps users to find nodes which are securing the sidechain so that the blockchain app and service stays secure. So our vision is some kind of a delegate marketplace on which you have an overview of all delegates on the network, and automatically it is scanned what kind of specification the node has, like how many gigabytes of RAM, how fast the processor is, and so on, because you might need different powerful nodes for different types of apps built on this. But there's also specified which third-party software is running. Like, is Ethereum running? Is IPFS running? And if you now want to hire or to pay this delegate, or you need delegates for your sidechain, then you can simply select those delegates which have all or which satisfy all requirements of your app or service. And we are following that philosophy that as long as one user wants to keep an app running, he should be able to do it. For example, nowadays Google is turning off services as crazy sometimes because they have no users or something else, but there are always some users, okay? Maybe there's only one guy who wants to keep that service running, and because it's useful for him, And Google decides to shut it down. What he does, he can't do anything.